Well, good morning and welcome to Coach's Corner on this first Saturday of 2018. And all of a sudden, Tia Goulet is nervous that she's going to be on the air, that everybody can see her eating her, looks like burrito on TV. There you go. That's all right. Let's go back to last night, a game heard on K104 and online at rjbroadcasting.com. The Bronco boys basketball team played their second of three home games this week as they hosted the 7-3 Mesabi East Giants. The game was a seesaw battle through the first 10 minutes of the game as there were four ties, six lead changes, but the Broncos took control of the game. They built a 9-point lead before leading 38-32 at the break. The Giants started chipping away at that lead and eventually would take the lead themselves 55-53 with just over 4.5 minutes remaining in the game. The Broncos could never regain the lead and they lose by a final score of 66-60. Tanner Budgers led the way for the Broncos with 18 points. Armando Barrios had 15 and Taylor Wilson 12. The boys are right back at home this afternoon. They are hosting the defending Section 7-2-A champions, the state runner-up from last year, Crosby Ironton, at 3 o'clock. Crosby lost most of that team, but it should be a dandy game at the Falls High Gym. The Bronco hockey team was in a shootout at Bronco Arena last night as they hosted Ely Northeast Range. The gold judges were busy through the first through the first two periods, as the two teams combined for 10 goals in the first period, 7 goals in the second period. The Falls led 7-3 after the first, 13-4 after two, and they win by a final score of 15-5. Here are the goal scorers in order. We'll do it that way. Kian Gonzalez, Brandon Beneke, Gus Lawrenson, Jackson Germain. Gonzalez with his second goal. Lawrenson with his second goal. Gonzalez had a hat trick before the end of the first period. Then Barrett Kaler. Gonzalez gets his fourth goal. Jordan Smith, Jackson Germain, his second. Butler, Palm a second time, and Beneke a second time for the 15 goals for the Broncos. Kane Koscheck had four assists in the game. Barrett Kaler and Trimble Butler each had three assists. The Broncos outshot the Timberwolves 48-17 in the game. The Broncos are in Silver Bay tonight. They will be taking on the North Shore Storm. That game is at 7 o'clock. The Bronco Titan wrestlers were in action last night. Unfortunately, no results of how they did. They are right back in Hibbing this morning at 10 o'clock. The Little Fork Big Falls Vikings boys basketball team headed to Cherry last night, and they got involved in a seesaw battle as well as the Vikings lose by a final score of 45-42. It was tied at 17 at halftime before the LBF Vikings built a 9-point lead, 32-23, with about 11 minutes left. The Tigers kept coming back. They'd come back. They eventually would take the lead 43-42 with just under 3 minutes remaining, and Cherry would score the only 2 points in the last 2:45 to win 45-42. Logan Lucan and Anthony Cipriano led LBF with 8 points each. The Fort Francis Muskie girls hockey team is in Thunder Bay for a weekend of games, and they got a 1-1 tie yesterday against the Queens Midget A team. CC Hayes got the lone goal with Taylor Croswell getting the assist. Fort Francis plays twice today. They are already underway as they take on the Queens Bantam Double A team at 8:45, and they take on Confederation College at 3 o'clock. In high school sports last night, let's start with boys basketball. Two Harbor 77, Cook County 71, Cromwell 59, Silver Bay 46. In the battle of the two close teams on the range, Virginia and Eveleth Gilbert, Virginia wins 58-83. Greenway 64-43 over Nashua Kiewit, and Floodwood 60-55 over McGregor. Mora 78, East Central 62. Chisholm 69-61 over MIB. Moose Lake Willow River 86, Southridge 55. Ely 100, Northeast Range. I saw 17 on the TV last night, 14 it says online this morning. Either way, Ely gets 100 to some teen number win. That's big. Esco 71, Barnum 50, Renshaw 65, Carlton 53, and Big Fork doubles up Northland 82-41. In girls basketball last night, Braham 60, Moose Lake Willow River 58, Two Harbors 65, Cook County 26. And here's a maybe putting everybody on alert game. Proctor 52, Aiken 29, Grand Rapids 81-47 over North Branch, and Virginia all over Hinckley-Finlayson 63-17. Boys hockey last night, Brainerd 4-0 over Roseau. Lake of the Woods gets a 13-0 shutout of Moose Lake Willow River. Duluth East stays undefeated 4-1 over Stillwater. Grand Rapids and Maple Grove 1-1 tie. Hermantown takes on St. Cloud Cathedral last night in a rematch of the state semifinals from last year in overtime. Hermantown gets a late goal. They win 4-3. Hibbing Chisholm 7-2 over Rochester Mayo. Virginia MIB loses to Proctor 3-2. Greenway gets beat by Holy Family Catholic 7-1. And War Road shuts out Detroit Lakes 6-0. Couple of girls hockey games from last night. Brainerd over Grand Rapids. Greenway 2-1. And Cloquet Esco Carlton 3-2. Over Hayward. The Timberwolves were in Boston last night, and despite 25 points and 23 rebounds from Karl Anthony Towns, the Timberwolves lost to maybe the best team in the Eastern Conference by a final score of 91-84. And the World Juniors wrapped up yesterday. The U.S. gets a 9-3 win over the Czech Republic to win the bronze medal, and Canada gets two goals 26 seconds apart in the last 2 minutes to defeat Sweden 3-1 for the gold medal. College hockey last night in the Big Ten, Ohio State 4-1 over Michigan State, Penn State 5-1 over Wisconsin, and number 2 Notre Dame 2-1 over Michigan. In the NCHC, number 4 Denver loses to Miami 4-3, number 6 UND loses to Omaha 4-1, and Bemidji State 3-0 over Lake Superior State, and Mankato State, who's ranked number 7 in the nation, they get a 5-2 win over Alaska Anchorage. In women's hockey, in the WCHA last night, St. Cloud State 5-0 over Mankato, Penn State 5-1 over Ohio State, Minnesota in an exhibition game, they beat the Minnesota Whitecaps 5-0, and UMD beats Team Korea, who's getting ready for it as they host the Olympics in just over a month. UMD wins that 3-0. What's going on locally today? Well, as I mentioned, the Bronco Titan wrestlers are back in Hibbing to get things started at 10 o'clock. The Bronco boys swimming and diving team is in Virginia today. The diving team at 10 o'clock and the swimmers start at 1. Bronco girls hockey at Bronco Arena at 2 o'clock for a game against maybe the top team in Section 7A in the Duluth Marshall Hilltoppers. The Bronco boys basketball team at home at 3 o'clock against CI, and the Bronco boys hockey team against North Shore in Silver Bay at 7 o'clock. Mentioned that the Muskie girls hockey teams have a pair of games in Thunder Bay today, and the Fort Francis Lakers are in Dryden for a 7:30 game. The Minnesota Wild, they will be in Colorado tonight for an 8 o'clock game, pregame at 7:45 on your home for the Minnesota Wild, KGHS, 12:30 a.m. The Gopher basketball team, we could go into a long whatever on the discussion on are the Gophers in trouble with the recent suspension of Reggie Lynch. They will see what they can do at home. They have Indiana at 4:15 today. That game is on ESPN2. The Timberwolves are at home against New Orleans. That game is at 8 o'clock. In the NFL playoffs, a couple of games today. The Chiefs host the Titans at 3:35. The Rams at home against the Falcons at 7:15. And maybe the biggest game on TV today, the national championship game in FCS. The North Dakota State Bison looking to get their sixth title in 7 years. They take on the defending champions, James Madison. That game starts at 11 o'clock on ESPN2. Tomorrow in the NFL, two more playoff games. The Bills getting back to the playoffs for the first time in 17 years. They're in Jacksonville. Who remembers the last time Jacksonville was in the playoffs? Apparently it's sooner, not as long ago as the Bills were, but the Jags are at home, a game at noon, and then the Panthers are at the Saints for a 3:40 game, and of course we have to wait to see who the Vikings will play. We do know that they play on Sunday, January 14th at 3:40. Gopher women's basketball team at home versus Michigan State tomorrow at 3 o'clock, and that game can be seen on BTN. What's happening with our former Broncos? Amy Oren and her UWF Rainy Falls hockey team, they're at Concordia today. Lexi Edwards with the Sacred Heart women's hockey team, they got a split last week versus Brown. They defeated St. Catharines last night 2-1. They play again this evening. Lucas DeBenedict got two goals and assists last Saturday in a 5-2 win for Northland College over Eau Claire. They're in Vermont for a pair of games this weekend. They lost to Norwich last night by a score of 5-1. Abby Koshik in the Moorhead State swimming team, is down in Florida. Nice place to go when it's nice and cold. Go down there, do a little swimming, see how things are going. They took part in the St. Petersburg Relays, and they came in second place out of four teams. And, of course, the indoor track and field season gets back into full swing this afternoon, or this morning, actually, starting Taylor Hebner with the UMD team there in Minneapolis for the Minnesota Open. And then Lexi Erickson, Brianna Schaffner, Savannah Olson, and Wyatt Helgeson all get back underway next week as the indoor season leads to the outdoor season, and we'll see how everything goes there. We're going to take a break, and my guests who have been patiently waiting, they have full stomachs, they're ready to go. The girls' basketball team, who's probably the what? I think you guys are the only Bronco team not in action today. I don't know how you guys planned that, but you guys did. They're here this morning. We'll talk to them when we come back. You're listening to Coach's Corner, live from Hardee's on K104 and online at rjbroadcasting.com.
I'll call them right now.
Welcome back to Coach's Corner. Is Jenna Sullivan going to be my savior? She's gonna save me. The Bronco boys hockey team is supposed to be here, and I know I told them 9:30, so it's only 9:16. We got lots of time.
Boys are always late.
And they want to eat at the right time because they got to get on the bus to Silver Bay. Joined by the Bronco girls basketball team head coach Jay Boyle, Grace Gilbert, Tia Goulet, Jenna Sullivan. I already mentioned her name, but I'll mention it again, I guess. You already knew she was here. And so, Coach, a game in Hibbing on Thursday night. Let's start there. Give me your impressions, because I didn't come talk to you about it yesterday. I was nervous.
You were nervous about asking me about it?
I was.
I like it when people don't talk to me until after I watch the film, so I can kind of see if, you know, what I remember is what actually went down and things like that. And it was verified that I was very happy with our game for a good majority of the game. For what would it be? We got 36 minutes. 31 out of our 36 minutes was fantastic. But from the 10-minute mark of the second half to the 5-minute mark of the second half, not so good. We got gassed. In the first half and at other points in the second, I thought we played some of our best basketball that we had played. I was very happy with where we were at, making some good decisions. We had, I think it was two or three turnovers in the second half. In the first half, short on rebounds, had a ton of assists. Shooting was a little off, but at least not as high as we normally have it. But we still finished 33% from the three-point line as a team on the game. Free throws were good, so... Hibbing's a very good team. Abby McDonald's a very good player, and it's good for us to go against those teams because, like as you mentioned with Proctor earlier, you know, the Proctor-Aiken game, probably a similar game. Is Hibbing a team that's 20 points better than us? That easily could have been a four-point game, except we let down, and Hibbing has that ability to stretch that out at that point. I have a feeling that's the same thing that happened with Proctor and Aiken. If we got to look at the actual game film, I'm guessing it was a much closer game than that, but... Proctor has those girls that can get out a run. They have an Abby McDonald with, I cannot remember, I always call her the Sam 2 because football coach's daughter, Sam Perendo, is always the first Sam to me. But but as far as Hibbing goes, I was very happy with her effort. Too bad we couldn't get it there. We were missing a rebounder, which might have helped.
Should we throw her under the bus? I was earlier telling her about back when you played in the day about some football players that were out running around on a certain island or in a certain park and how Coach Nordquist had gotten hold of them and told them you're going to ruin a state championship type season by being out running around and somebody's going to get an eye poked out, and she just bashed me. She just said, she told me to mind my own business. Just, did you never mind?
She gets a little defensive.
Don't you dare tell me what I should can and cannot be doing. I'm an adult now and I'm a big girl.
No,
and
I thought that was serious.
I'm kidding. A little bit. She did tell me to back off, Jenna Sullivan. You did, right?
Yeah. I was just like, you know, I had a fun weekend. Yeah, if it would have been worse, if I would have been sitting 2 weeks, I would probably be way more devastated. It was fun at the time, but it also super sucked even just sitting one game because it's, you know, it's senior year and you want to play every game you can.
So you can describe the injury because I've been kind of told bits and pieces. So you might as well just tell everybody what happened so we all know.
All right. So I basically landed on it wrong.
coming down off a rock wall.
Yeah. I'm like,
let's just get it out there because it's sounding worse. You're making it sound worse than it actually was. Okay. But not saying it. So she came down off a bone coming down off a rock wall.
Yeah, so I dropped about, I don't know, like 5 feet from where my feet were off the ground, but the mat was squishy, so it was just super, probably just a little bit too unstable. So my feet came out because I came off the rock wall, so I was swinging, and then I dropped down and I landed on it. And the doctor called it like a sub dislocation or something like that, where it's like the bone pops. So like when I landed on it, my bone popped out of socket.
And then right
back. And then I twisted my foot and it popped back into socket. So talk about the best way to spend New Year's Eve. So then we go to the ER and he was like, basically your season's over. And instantly it was just like tears. And I was like, ah. And then he was like, just kidding. Just kidding. Basketball goes till March. And I'm like, yeah, it does. So then I went and saw Wyatt Levine, and then he told me that I could start putting pressure on it and start working back into practice, like, probably 5 days later. But it's just because my ankles have been sprained so many times that my ligaments and my tendons are so stretched out that it actually helps it heal faster in a way. I don't know.
Interesting. Very interesting. That's a great explanation. We appreciate it. Because this is the big and concisive news that we need here on Coach's Corner, right, Coach?
That's right. Getting right down into the deep stuff here. So the moral of the story is she's looking pretty good, and we're hopeful for next week.
Because it's a busy couple of weeks coming up. I don't want to go to that yet. Let's talk about Thursday night's game a little bit. You guys probably played more man-to-man in that game than maybe you have combined the entire season, Coach?
I agree, and I was very happy with our ability to do that. Now, Hibbing is a team that they didn't move great. I wouldn't call them a fast team in their half court. They don't move incredibly well in their half court. They're slower. They're more deliberate in what they do, trying to set up the screens and things like that, which I think played for us and allowed us to be in that man defense more, and we matched up with them. And I also think with Jenna being out, Chloe replaced her, and she gives us a little more too because she has that kind of cross-country mentality. I didn't look at how much she actually played, but I think she played like 28 out of the 36 minutes, and doesn't have a huge letdown when she gets tired. She can kind of just keep moving. So having her out there, and she can kind of guard inside and outside, allowed the man decision to be a little easier for us. Plus, I didn't think we could play zone against them. They shoot really well, especially at home.
Grace, you had a pretty important role in there. You got to take on Abby most of the game. Now, some people might say, well, Abby McDonald scored 31 points, so Grace didn't do it. I thought you did a pretty darn good job. How would you grade yourself out on the job you did on Thursday?
Well, I'm not always too impressed with my defense, but I didn't think it was that bad against her. I didn't really notice she scored that many points until after the game.
I felt the same way, and I was sitting there watching it, and I got to the end, and I'm like, wow. Holy, yeah, okay.
The eight points in the first half we were extremely happy with, holding her to eight in the first. But
absolutely. And it was kind of, and I'll say it this way, Grace, it was a team effort because obviously you had to be fairly aggressive against her, but your teammates were helping you behind her, behind you as well.
Yeah, for sure. We had a lot of really good help defense.
Tia, we got to get you in here. You're sitting over there, arms folded, like, when are you going to get me on the air? I want to talk. I like being on the air. I like coming up and doing the post-game interview, and you're not letting me talk. She's mad. No pouting as a senior here now, Tia.
And,
I'm just kidding. So talk your impressions. It was a 19-point game in the final, the 80-61. But what did you kind of feel like that the Broncos did well on Thursday night at Hibbing?
I think we did really well on defense. We moved and we, like, called out screens. I remember, like, calling out screens for Libby was always like right there, right behind me if I ever needed help, and if she ever needed help, we were always right there to help her out.
All right, let's move on. Big next 2 weeks.
I got one more thing.
One more thing.
That's good. One more thing I was happy with. I thought we finished the game pretty well, which is something that we've been working on as far as following, knowing the clock situation, getting down to running offense and being smarter with those end-of-game situations, which is something we've had to drill in practice a few times because it's something I didn't think we did very well. But with 10 minutes left, it was in that second half, it was a 4-point game. 5 minutes left in that half, it was a 17-point game. And it ended up being a 19-point game. So in the last In that last 5 minutes, we only had a negative two run when we were falling in that, and they shot good free throws. So I was happy with our effort towards the end of the game. We didn't quit. We kept trying no matter what the score was. I was proud of the girls for that.
So coming up, there's some big games coming up. As I mentioned, 6 games in 2 weeks. We start on Monday against MIB. Looking for a response. Stone-faced just about coaching. Do you like that?
Stone-faced. I want to hear from you guys.
Talk to me about MIB, Grace.
They're really just not who they were before. Like, they lost a lot of seniors last year, and I think we have a really good chance against them.
What's the key, Tia?
Just keep our heads high and play our game.
Jenna, how about for you?
You know, MIB is a name. And that's how I feel. Wow. It seems like every year we go out there and we beat ourselves before we even play the game. So I feel like if we go out there and we just play our game and we maintain our mindset that we can beat them, I feel like we can beat
Grace,
them.
You got something to add to that? You look like you were raising your hand like you wanted to add.
I was up arrowing that. Oh, yeah. That was really good.
It is really good. So I'll ask the question, and maybe this is where the answer, maybe this is where the difficulty lies. How do you make that happen? How do you put that into play? What happens between Saturday morning now when we're talking about it and Monday evening when the ball goes up at about 7:15? What does this team need to do? And I'll let coach or the players take this one. What has to go into the brain set to answer that question about, forget about that it's MIB, let's go out and play our game? Is it as simple as that?
Yeah.
Or does something else need to happen?
No, it's as simple as that. We just need to go out there confident. That's like, we are a good team, but we don't walk out there like we're a good team. A lot of times we get nervous over games that we shouldn't get nervous about, but we think teams are better than us, so we take ourselves out of the game almost.
Coach?
I got nothing. They're doing great here.
That's a great answer. All right, so we'll have that game on the air for you, by the way, on Monday night on K104 and RJBroadcasting.com. If you cannot make it to the Falls Eye Gym, come on and join along. I'll do the best this I can. Thursday, War Road? Is that right? No.
Thursday we go to Eveleth.
Thursday, Eveleth.
Yep.
I had the black and gold. I had that.
You did. That was right. No, World was about this time last year, but we moved it later into the season. I think it's in our last week of the season, actually.
Okay. So Eveleth Gilbert, second time you'll get a chance to play them.
Yep, and our team, always tough that second time. We got to just show up and play. You know, I like our matchup against them. We did well the first time, and I think it's going to be one of those times where we do better the second time against them than we do the first time. But we just got to show up and play. Concentrate on things we've been concentrating on, which is mainly securing rebounds and not giving up second chance points, and we should be okay there.
Saturday,
we got Two Harbors coming up.
Two Harbors at home at 2:30 next Saturday.
Yep.
What do we know about the Agates, ladies? Anything? Nope, boy.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
Uh-oh.
You want me to say it?
Grace, go ahead.
Well, yeah.
She got bulletin board material?
Well, we'll explain Grace's other role on the team.
Well, don't make it sound like that. It's really not that bad.
No, it's not bad. It's just your role. It's what you do.
She's out there.
So we're at Hibbing, and all of a sudden, and it's before the game starts, okay. And I get a call from Tia, actually, who was apparently calling me to ruin Grace's surprise, because Grace... I call her my social media stalker because
that's what I was.
Pretty much when something happens out there in the girls' basketball world, I pretty much hear because Grace is friends with all of them. So Tori Bott apparently sprained her ankle or did something, so we're not sure that Tori Bott's going to be around on Saturday.
I noticed after the game at Hibbing, Coach, and I think you probably did too, you probably didn't get home till like after midnight because Grace was on the floor talking. I don't know to whom it was. But
we asked her to move more than once. But
and I think I had done the post-game show, packed up, posted everything out onto Facebook and Twitter world, and I was walking out the door, and she still hadn't left the floor yet, Coach. I don't know.
I'm sure she's going to turn that into a very marketable skill in her later life.
I hope so. I'm not sure.
I think it probably can happen that way. All right, let's go to the next week. Esko at home on Monday.
Yep.
Esko bounced you for the playoffs last year. Am I got that right? I'm thinking, is that 2 years?
Yep, it was Esko.
It was Esko last year.
Because I remember when Esko coming out, and you know, it was a however point game it ended up being in the second half, and Esko took all their seniors out, and I remember looking at there and turning at the girls and being like, girls, this is the team you're going to see next year, okay? I know we had a rough one here tonight. Esko's a very good team, but this team that's coming up, this team we can play with. And, you know, they lost one of those girls to a transfer to a different school. So I think our biggest thing against ESCO is they got Yellen, Yetzin. They have a big girl. Yeah. They got a 6'2" girl. So it all comes along with our rebounding discussions. If we can start boxing out and take care of that, I feel very good about our ESCO game this year. Quite frankly, I feel like this is the first time that since I've been working here, that the north subsection is stronger than the south section. We have Duluth Marshall and Proctor in with us, and it might be one of the only years that I'm in favor of the crossover in the quarterfinals.
There you go. What do you guys know about ESCO? What's the skinny? Tia, what do you got? Anything?
Well, I have one of my sister's friends that was from ESCO, and so she's giving me all the details. I'm like, oh, this girl can shoot. This girl loves to drive. Just keep a hand up. And
see? Try to take Grace's spot. There you go. Tuesday the 16th, you guys are at home against Northwoods. Enough said?
And then Thursday, Duluth Denfeld comes up.
And that's a pretty big one. Yes? No?
No.
No.
I really hope no one from Duluth Denfeld is listening, but the Duluth Denfeld basketball program is struggling.
Yeah, it's struggling, and of course, it's one of those games that everybody looks at. You look at the name and you say, well, it's Duluth Denfeld. It's got to be a big game, but they lose maybe their best player to Duluth Marshall.
They definitely lose their best player to Duluth Marshall last year. The star of the Duluth Marshall team is the former Duluth Denfeld eighth grader.
And so we've got that to take care of. Who else is out there? Can I talk about those six games? Biggest game left on the schedule after that. Grace?
Proctor.
Proctor. Tia?
Proctor.
Proctor. Tia? Jenna? Who?
I said Proctor.
Proctor.
That one.
That's it. Proctor? Yeah. Yeah.
Well, let me tell you about our February. Our February, we have our February, and I forget the order of it, but it goes something like Proctor at home on Friday, go to Duluth Marshall on Saturday. Then the next week or the week before, I don't remember, is...
We got Virginia on the 2nd at Virginia.
Yep.
Yeah.
But we got two Fridays and Saturdays. We're home on Friday, go to Duluth on Saturday. And in there we have Marshall, Proctor. We play Roseau in February. We have our second Virginia game in February. And I'm missing someone else big that we got coming up in February, too.
All four of those teams are
that I really like what we... I'll throw a prop out there to Athletic Director Bill Mason. I like our schedule this year. You know, I don't think we have any four-game weeks this year. We got that balanced out, and we finished our February strong. We don't have a big break before playoffs, and I like the workup that we're going to have going into playoff run, because with these seven seniors that have been around forever, that's what we're going for.
I don't know if they
we might have just made Grace cry.
Thanks for being here this morning. Thanks for coming as early as you did. Jenna, it's always good to have somebody to talk to. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Jenna Sullivan, Tia Goulet, Grace Gilbert, head coach Jay Boyle joining me here. We'll take a break. We'll come back with more from Coach's Corner here from Hardee's. You're listening on K104 and online at rjbroadcasting.com.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Hardee's for our next segment. And our guests were supposed to have showed up this morning, didn't show up, so we'll be all right. We'll talk about a few things, and let's talk about the NFL playoffs as the ladies leaving here. Thanks again to them. And so let's talk about the NFL playoffs. As you know, my good friend Mike Bolstead, he would love to be here to have a conversation about this. And of course, the playoffs start this afternoon with a 3:35 game as the Kansas City Chiefs take on the Tennessee Titans, in a game that probably 2 months ago you'd looked at it and you said, well, hey, the Chiefs are going to win this game very easily. Maybe 2.5 months ago, this is one of the best teams in the NFL, blah, blah, blah. The Titans were a pretty decent team, but they maybe limped down the stretch a little bit. And I'll give you my prediction. I'll go with the Chiefs in a game that they'll probably win by about 10 points will be my prediction. Although I was listening on ESPN Radio, I think on the way home on Thursday night from Hibbing, and somebody said this is their upset special. This is the Titans are going to come up with the upset. So, hey, makes it very interesting. That game is on ESPN. The game tonight, the Los Angeles Rams, I still have a tough time saying that at times after I grew up with them being the Los Angeles Rams, and then they became the St. Louis Rams, and et cetera, et cetera. But the Los Angeles Rams, first playoff game in a while there at home against the Atlanta Falcons, of course, the team that went to the Super Bowl last year. The Falcons just have not looked great during this year. This is one person's opinion. The Rams, of course, with their new coach and the young buck, and he's got everybody going in the right direction and all this other stuff. This could be the game where you get the upset here. This is the number 6 versus the number 3. The Atlanta Falcons have been there. That's the point I'm trying to make here. I think they possibly could make a run here, and that might be your upset of the day, where the number 6 seed, the Falcons, take down the Rams. That would change things up for the Vikings, because that would make sure that the Rams, or excuse me, the Falcons, would end up playing number 1 Philadelphia Eagles, and then, of course, the Vikings would get the winner of the other game. But, of course, like I said, we have to wait and see what happens there. Tomorrow, Jacksonville versus the Bills, the two teams maybe that haven't been in the playoffs for the while. Jacksonville, a very, 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 very good defense, maybe just a step under the Vikings. I think they probably have one of the best team defenses in the NFL. And, of course, the Bills get in as the number 6 seed there, as the number 6 seed. They take on the Jags. That game is at noon tomorrow. I'm going to go with the Jags, and only reason other than the defense is that they are at home. And then the big game, the Saints versus the Panthers, the 4-5 game in the NFC. In this game, of course, if you listen to my good friend Mike Bolstead, this is a no-brainer. The Saints might be the best team in the NFL right now, according to him. They could definitely make a run at the playoffs. Also heard that on ESPN on my way home Thursday night, that New Orleans could be the best team right now in the NFC and possibly the NFL. They take on the Panthers, who, as somebody mentioned, they're not consistent on offense, and they're not a team that probably can make a run. So I'll go with the Saints, and so my picks, I'm going to go with the Chiefs. I'm going to go with the Rams. I'm going to stay right there because they're at home, the Jags and the Saints. So I'm going with all the favorites. I'm going with all the home teams. Some people might say that that's falling out and taking the easy way out, but I'll tell you that if that's the way that it works out, the Vikings will be taking on the Los Angeles Rams on Sunday, January 14th. I want to take this opportunity also to mention two free throw shooting contests coming up over the next two Sundays. The Elks hoop shoot takes place tomorrow at the Falls High Gymnasium, and I don't have an exact start time for that, and I apologize, I forgot to look at the poster last night when I was at the basketball game. I believe that it's a 1 o'clock start. Don't quote me on that. If you need more information, get a hold of Charlie Anderson. He is in charge. And then next Sunday, January 14th, the Knights of Columbus will be putting on their free throw shooting championship. That goes on at Rainy River Community College, and I know that one because I'm in charge of it. The shooting begins at 1 o'clock, registration from noon to 1, and I know for the Knights of Columbus, it's any girl or boy ages 9 to 14 on January 1st, 2018. So if just a week ago or so ago, you are 9 to 14 years old, we'd love to have you come over and be a part of the free throw shooting contest at Rainy River Community College on January 14th. The Elks, 8 to 13 are the age groups there, and a little bit different age groups, and that goes on at the Falls High Gymnasium tomorrow afternoon. We'll take a break, and we'll come back, and we'll go over the week that was and the week that's coming up. You're listening to Coach's Corner, live from Hardee's on K104 and online at rjbroadcasting.com. Welcome back to Coach's Corner for our final segment, and let's talk about what went on this past week. Let's go back to last Saturday, and let's start as I was down in the Twin Cities for the third-place game for the Bronco girls hockey team, and they get a 4-3 win over Duluth in the third-place game in overtime. It was an exciting game. The Falls trailed 1-0 after the first. It was tied at 1 after 2. Grace Bragg scored a pair of goals, one in the second, one in the third. Amber Thielander got a goal in the third period, and Duluth forced the overtime, and Marissa Carey got her first goal of the season on the power play in overtime, and the Broncos, they win 4-3 in overtime after losing to Duluth 4-3 in overtime earlier in the season. The Bronco boys hockey team was in War Road. They wrapped up their holiday play there with a 2-0 loss to the home team, War Road. The Bronco boys swimming and diving team hosted a six-team invitational last Saturday. Hibbing won the meet with 449 points. They were just better than Mesabi East at 297, Virginia at 211, and the Falls at 171.
Individual finishes, Robert Sweeney was second in diving. Logan Phillips was third. Alex Bellinger took fourth in the 100 fly. Jake Slatinski took sixth in the 500 free. The 200 free relay took fifth place. That team was of Alex Bissonnette, Gavin Wilson, Tanner Sether, and Alex Bellinger. And the 400 free relay took fourth place. Tanner Sether led it off, then Jake Slatinski, Alex Bissonnette, and Alex Bellinger. No action on Sunday and Monday. It was New Year's Eve and New Year's Day. On Tuesday, the Bronco Boys basketball team had their two-game winning streak broke by the Green Bay Raiders by a final score of 61-49. It was a three-point game with 3 minutes remaining, and Green Bay scored the last 9 points for the final margin of 12. The Bronco Boys swimming and diving team had their second multi-team meet in 4 days as they traveled to Grand Rapids. The Falls took third place with 187 points behind Virginia, who won the meet with 282, and Grand Rapids, the host team, had 251. Top finishes, the 200 medley relay took fourth place. Alex Bellinger, Ben Keeney, Alex Bissonnette, and Tanner Sether. The 200 free relay took fourth place. Keeney, Colin Hebner, Gavin Wilson, and Sether. And the 400 free relay took fourth place. Bissonnette, Sether, Jake Slatinski, and Bellinger on that relay team there. Individually, Gavin Wilson took 2 fifth place in the 100 free and the 200 free. Jake Slatinski took third in the 200 IM. Alex Bissonnette, a fifth place in the 200 IM and third in the 100 butterfly. Alex Bellinger, second in the 50 free, second in the 500 free. Logan Phillips took second in diving, and Robert Sweeney took third. On Wednesday, the Fort Francis Lakers returned from their nearly two-week layoff for the holidays with a home game against the Minnesota Iron Rangers. The visitors scored 2 goals in each of the 3 periods, and the home team had to score 4 times in the third to force overtime, tied at 6. Neither team would score in the overtime, and the Rangers would win the shootout 1-0. Jaden Ness led the Lakers with a pair of goals. The Rainy River men's basketball team came back early from the break. They were out in North Dakota for a pair of games, and they opened with a 91-70 win over Lakes Region. The Voyagers led by just 4 at the break before they used a strong second half, to pull away. Devarius Wright had 19, Anthony Mara 17, Jean-Paul Schifino 13, and Greg Barber had 11 to lead the Voyagers. On Thursday, we talked about this with our guests here this morning. The Bronco girls basketball team played a big IRC battle in Hibbing that was close throughout. It was 34-30 at the half. The Falls actually would, the Broncos were down at half. The Broncos would actually take the lead with about 15 minutes left, but it was all Hibbing from there as they won 80-61 over the Broncos. Janet Humbert, 14. Libby Miggins, 13. Grace Gilbert, 12. Emma Gilbert, 11. No Jenna Sullivan, as we mentioned in that game. Sorry, Jenna, I had to say it again. It was a big difference in that basketball game. That's the point I'm trying to make. The Broncos maybe gave up too many second and third chance opportunities to the Blue Jackets in the second half. The Little Fork Big Falls Viking girls basketball team, they hosted Black Duck in a game at the LBF Gymnasium. And what a game it was. Let me just play it down for you. It's 47-46 with 15 seconds remaining. Possession to Black Duck. They're leading 47-46. They get an over and back call. That allows the Vikings to take the ball out with 10 seconds. They get a shot, miss. Get a putback, miss, and then Kate Knabel gets it in her hands. She lets it go with 1 second left. She beats the buzzer, and the Vikings win by a score of 48-47. What an exciting way to start year 2018 for the LBF girls basketball team. Emily Franz had 18 points on the night, and Kate Knabel with that last buzzer-beating bucket, she ends up with 10. The Fort Francis Muskie boys were over at Kitson County Central for a game on Thursday night. They win 6-5 in overtime. Eric Pickenin, he's the star of the game. He scores the game-tying goal in the waning seconds with the goaltender pulled, and also scores the overtime winner. The Rainy River men's basketball team completed their road trip out to North Dakota, and they led 47-41 over Dakota College Bottineau, but they couldn't hang on as they were outscored by 17 points in the second half, and they lose by a final of 93-82. DeVarius Wright had 23, Anthony Mara 19, and Isaiah Sims, had 16 in their loss. And owner Dave Peterson comes over, hands me a piece of paper that says the Vikes are going to win the Super Bowl by a score of 24. Who are they going to play?
Probably Pittsburgh
with the newfound information about the New England Patriots, with all the maybe the infighting that they're talking about. He says the Pittsburgh Steelers lose to the Vikings 24-10 in the Super Bowl. Last night, Bronco boys basketball loses to Mesabi East 66-60. A game that was at home. Broncos led for portions of that game, big portions of those game. Couldn't hang on down the stretch. The Bronco boys hockey team, 15-5 over Ely Northeast Range last night. They led 7-3 after the first, 13-4 after two. They win 15-5. King Gonzalez, he had four goals in that hockey game last night. The LBF boys basketball team, they lose to Cherry by a final score of 45-42, and the Fort Frances girls hockey team got a 1-1 tie in Thunder Bay last night. They got a couple of games going on today. Let's talk more about that. What's going on today? Very, very busy day. We'll start with the Fort Frances girls hockey team. They are taking on a team this morning at 8:45, the Queens Bantam AA team, and then they take on Confederation College, at 3 o'clock this afternoon. Let's stay with the hockey. The Bronco girls hockey team against maybe the best team in Section 7A. I know I keep saying that. They are probably the highest ranked team. And Duluth Marshall coming to town. That game gets started at 2 o'clock at Bronco Arena. The boys hockey team, after their big win last night, they get on the bus. They head to Silver Bay for a 7 o'clock game against North Shore. The Bronco swimming and diving team, boys swimming and diving team, just getting ready with the diving portion in Virginia at 10 o'clock. The swimming begins at 1. The Bronco Titan wrestlers are in Hibbing. That two-day tournament resumes at 10 a.m. And then the other thing going on today, the Bronco boys basketball team, after their loss last night, they get to take on Crosby Arrington again. Crosby Arrington, the defending Section 7-2A champions. They were state runner-ups last year. Their five starters all gone off of the team from last year. They are rebuilding, but they're Crosby Arrington. They got one of maybe the best coaches ever in Dave Galovich, and I have no bones about saying that he's maybe one of the best high school coaches in the state of Minnesota, and he always makes it difficult for teams. No action going on tomorrow. On Monday, we mentioned the Bronco girls basketball team at home against MIB. We'll have that game for you on K104 and online at rjbroadcasting.com with the pregame to start right around 7 o'clock. The Viking girls basketball team is at home against Ely. That game starts at 6:30, and the Rainy River basketball teams will be down in Superior to take on the UWS JV team. Women at 4, and I believe the men are at 6 o'clock. I didn't get a confirmation on that off the website, but I believe those games at 4 and 6 o'clock. Tuesday, very, very busy day as well. The girls' hockey team from the Falls, they'll be in Bemidji for a 7 o'clock game. I'll be down there with Mike Bolstead to bring you coverage of that one on K104. The boys' hockey team is at home on Tuesday night against Virginia. The Fort Frances boys and girls' hockey teams, they will be taking on Beaver Bray on Tuesday. The Fort Frances Nordic cross country team, Nordic ski teams, cross country teams there in Atticoken for a meet. The Little Fork Big Falls Viking boys basketball team is at home against LaPorte. The Viking girls are on the road at Hill City. On Wednesday, the Fort Frances boys hockey team, they get right back on the ice. They take on Dryden at the Duke at 7:15. The girls hockey team takes on Dryden at 1:30, and the Lakers are in Thunder Bay for a game on Wednesday. On Thursday, I'll be down in Little Fork to bring you boys basketball on the air as the Viking boys host Southridge. That pregame to start right around 7 o'clock. The boys hockey team, they'll have their hands full on Thursday night. They'll be down in the Snake Pit as they take on Greenway in Coleraine. The girls basketball team is at Eveleth on Thursday night, and the Bronco Titan wrestlers will be in Grand Rapids for a triangular that starts at 6 o'clock. Kind of a slow Friday next week. The girls hockey team is in Park Rapids for a 6 o'clock game. The Lakers are at home for a 7:30 game against Minnesota, and the Rainy River men's and women's basketball teams will be in Hibbing for 5:30 and 7:30 games. And I say a slow Friday only in the fact that there's only four games going on. That's crazy. That's not the normal Friday. Next Saturday, huge day. The Bronco boys basketball team, they'll be in Proctor for a 5 o'clock game. The Bronco girls basketball team at home at 2:30 next Saturday against Two Harbors. The girls hockey team at home against Crookston on Saturday. The Lakers will be down in Hoyt Lakes to take on the Minnesota Iron Rangers for a 7 o'clock game. The Rainy River men's and women's basketball teams will be at home against Vermilion at 1 and 3 o'clock. And our game on the air next Saturday night, 6 o'clock, the drop of the puck, 5:40 pregame as the Broncos take on St. Paul Johnson Governors for the first time. And I didn't go back and even look, but by next Saturday, I figured out the last time that the Broncos and the Governors took part against one another, I would guess could be in the state tournament way back in the 60s and or the 70s. That's going to wrap it up here for Coach's Corner this week. Thanks to Ryan back at the station for pushing all the buttons. Thanks to Dave and his crew here at Hardee's for taking care of our guests. Thank you to our guests, the Bronco girls basketball team, for being here. Thanks to our sponsors, but most of all, thank you for listening to Coach's Corner. Live from Hardee's on K104 and online at rjbroadcasting.com.